Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Grieving a Suicide, A Loved One's Search for Comfort, Answers, and Hope by Albert Y. Shih. Narrated by David Shih. In memory of my father, Terry Tsai-Yuan Shih, 1939 to 1998. Oh, great and just God, no man among us knows what the sleeper knows, nor is it for us to judge what lies between him and thee. Prayer at a funeral after a suicide. In Willa Cather's My Antonia. Almighty God, Father of mercies and giver of comfort, deal graciously, we pray, with all who mourn, that, casting all their care on you, they may know the consolation of your love. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Book of Common Prayer. Introduction. For survivors, the other victims of suicide. One of my students once described her cousin's suicide and its continuing effects on his family by saying, "He didn't just take his own life, he took part of theirs too." Gilbert Mylander, Bioethics. If you have experienced the suicide of a loved one, this book is for you. Approximately 1 million people around the world kill themselves each year. In the United States, over 42,000 suicides take place annually, perhaps far more, since many suicides are disguised to look like accidents. While suicides often take place in isolation, they are rarely unnoticed by others. There may be one primary victim, but as with a bomb thrown into a crowd of people, the collateral damage done to others nearby is massive. An individual suicide causes numerous other casualties. Friends and family, the other victims. Every suicide leaves behind at least 6 survivors, sometimes 10 or more. In most literature on the topic, suicide survivor refers to a loved one left behind by suicide. Husband, wife, parent, child, roommate, co-worker, another family member, friend, not a person who has survived a suicide attempt. It is no coincidence that the term survivor is commonly applied to those who have experienced a horrible catastrophe of earth-shattering proportions. We speak of Holocaust survivors or of survivors of genocide, terrorism, or war. So it is with those of us who survive a suicide. According to the American Psychiatric Association, the level of stress resulting from the suicide of a loved one is ranked as catastrophic, equivalent to that of a concentration camp experience. Survivor suggests desperation, one who clings to life, but only barely. The TV show Survivor created an artificial environment in which a group of people is stranded in a remote location to fend for themselves. But their actual survival was never really in doubt. After all, there are camera crews, directors, and production assistants on hand to chronicle their everyday experiences. Not so with the survivors of a true catastrophe, like a shipwreck or plane crash. These survivors do not have any guarantee of survival. Their lives hang in the balance. They may have survived an initial life-threatening crisis, but they face an ongoing day-to-day challenge of survival, with no assurance of safety, rescue, or recovery. Such is the case for survivors of suicide. We have experienced a trauma on par psychologically with the experience of soldiers in combat. In the aftermath, we simply don't know if we can endure the pain and anguish. Because death has struck so close to home, life itself seems uncertain. We don't know if we can go on from day to day. We wonder if we will be consumed by the same despair that claimed our loved one. At the very least, we know that our life will never be the same. If we go on living, we will do so as people who see the world very differently. Shortly after my father's suicide, I purchased a dozen books on the topic. Most sat on my shelf unread for months. I discovered that I was unable to bring myself to read them. Many times I would pick one up and attempt to read a few pages, only to abandon it when tears clouded my vision. If this is your experience as well, that's fine. You certainly do not need to listen to this book straight through from beginning to end. In fact, you may not be able to. Listen to only what you can handle. Feel free to skip around and go directly to chapters that you think may be helpful to you. The chapters in the first part of the book deal more directly with the immediate grief experience, whereas the second part attempts to answer the haunting questions that suicides present. The third section offers further reflection on living one's life following a suicide. Some things I read early in my own grieving made no sense to me at the time. They seemed too trite, like simplistic pat answers. My emotions were probably too raw then, my grief too fresh. Now that some time has passed, things make a little more sense. So if some of my observations are of no help to you right now, I apologize in advance and pray that I have not added to your grief. I do not pretend to offer the authoritative word on this topic, but I hope this book can be a companion through your experience. I grew up in Minnesota, a state known for frigid winters and heavy snowfall. The wind chill factor falls so far below zero that merely taking a breath brings sharp pain to your lungs and makes your nostrils freeze up. I remember childhood blizzards when I looked out the window and couldn't even see the end of the driveway. The dark skies, icy streets, and arctic winds made it nearly impossible to travel anywhere or even to see where to go. These storms are dangerous. Without proper protection, people caught outside can die. But eventually, the storms subside, leaving an altered landscape. Familiar landmarks have disappeared under a cover of crystal white. It can be hazardous to venture outdoors after a new snow. Many slip and fall on the ice, breaking hips or wrists. Every year, some people have heart attacks while shoveling their driveways. Even walking through the snow can be risky. If the top layer of the snow is crusted over with ice, the surface appears deceptively solid. But with one misplaced step, your leg can break through the crust and sink up to your thigh. Soon enough, however, shovels and snowblowers emerge, and gradually, the sidewalks reappear, marked by the boot prints of those who clear new paths. It's always easier to walk through snowdrifts if you place your feet in the footsteps of those who trudged through earlier. Survivors of suicide can feel as if they are caught in a winter storm of epic proportions. The road ahead looks bleak and daunting. It may not seem to lead anywhere, or you may seem to be going in circles. You may feel as if you are frozen in place. You may think that you'll die. But wherever you are on the journey, know that the path you tread is one that others have trod. I hope this book provides you with some protection in the storm, that it will guard your heart and soul during a time of terrible agony. May it provide you with some tracks to follow to make your way through. Part 1. When suicide strikes. Suicide doesn't end pain. It only lays it on the broken shoulders of the survivors. Anne Grace Shinen. 1. Shock. It was a Thursday morning when I heard. I had been getting ready for work. I was looking forward to the weekend because my wife, Ellen, and I were going to a friend's wedding in Minnesota. We planned to visit my parents while we were in the state. In preparation, I gathered a few things to bring with us, including some enlargements of our wedding photos for my mother and a book for my dad. I also had a copy of our wedding video for my parents. Ellen and I had gotten married 9 months prior. The video was unlabeled, so I played the first few seconds to make sure it was the right one. I caught a glimpse of my mother being ushered down the aisle and the back of my father's head as he started to follow. I stopped the video and put it back in its case. Then the phone rang. I couldn't think who would be calling us so early in the morning. The voice on the line seemed unearthly, a combination of howls and sobs. Who was this? Was it a wrong number? Then I realized that it was my mother, in hysterics. Her voice was overwhelmed with emotion, terror, grief. Daddy killed himself, she wailed. What? I asked. What happened? Mom, what happened? But she had left the phone, and I could hear her sobbing in the background. Daddy? Daddy who? My dad? Ellen looked at me with a puzzled expression on her face, and I gestured for her to listen in. Mom? Mom? Are you there? I yelled into the phone. Mom! For several agonizing seconds, we heard little on the other end of the line. Then she was back and told me that she had found Dad's body that morning. I asked if she had called the police. They were there now, she said. She left the phone again, evidently to talk to somebody. Then a neighbor's voice came on the line, and she told me what little she knew. Albert, your father strangled himself, the neighbor said. Your mom needs you to come home. Then she had to hang up because the police needed the phone. But she said that someone would call us back soon. I hung up the phone in shock. Ellen held me and started to cry. An unfeeling numbness seeped through my body. I sat down on the couch, not quite able to grasp what had happened. I couldn't wrap my mind around the concept. Suicide? My dad? Ellen called our workplace to tell them what had happened, that we would be leaving for Minnesota right away. She called our alma mater and left a message for one of the professors, whom we had planned to visit that weekend, to let him know of the unexpected change of plans. She also left a message for the college faculty, asking for prayer for my family. She then called our church and left a message for our pastor. She started to pack. I still sat on the couch, not believing that this was really taking place. Was this real? Had this actually happened? My father, age 58, had had a stroke 3 months prior, just before Thanksgiving. He had lost some motor function in the left side of his body and had begun a rehabilitation and therapy program. He had become very depressed after the stroke, and I knew he had been having a hard time coming to terms with the loss of autonomy and control over his own body. A month earlier, we had heard some encouraging news that things seemed to be going better. But now, suddenly, he was gone. My mom called again a few minutes later. In a calmer voice, she told me that my dad had attempted suicide a week earlier. She had wanted to tell me when it happened, but my dad didn't want me to know. He hadn't wanted me to worry about him, to be burdened by that knowledge. I was going to tell you this weekend, Mom said sadly. She asked if we would be coming home, and I told her we were packing. I said we'd see her that afternoon, and we hung up. As we packed, we got more phone calls. A professor from our college called and told us that the campus would be praying for us. Our pastor, Matthew, called and asked if he could come over to see us. We said that we were about to leave, but we'd be stopping by our office on our way out of town. Ellen's supervisor called to let us know that the company would be praying for us that morning. Within an hour, we had gathered our things for the drive home. I packed the wedding video, which my father would now never see. Before we left our apartment, I saw the book I had planned to bring to my dad. I placed it back on the shelf. I had thought about giving it to him some months ago, but hadn't gotten around to it. Now he would never read it, or anything else. Now, it was too late. The shock of discovery. The initial impact of discovery scars us forever, declares one suicide survivor. Some survivors have the horrible experience of witnessing the actual suicide. In the midst of a heated argument, one young woman's husband shouted, "I'll show you," just before shooting himself. Another man, in the process of a divorce, told his wife that he could not live without her. She watched in horror as he put a gun to his head and pulled the trigger. "I don't think I can ever get over this," she says. Others have the shock of discovering the body, and thereafter are haunted by images of blood and death. Pictures are seared in our memory. "I will never be able to get the image of him, lying on the floor with a hose to the gas and a trash bag over his head, out of my mind," says a survivor. Those of us who hear about the discovery after the fact, while spared the graphic memory of our loved one's act, nonetheless are plagued by our imaginations. We wonder what the scene looked like. We envision the final moments. Whether we witnessed the death or not, we replay images over and over in our head, like a movie on a loop that we can't turn off. Survivors of suicide have a variety of initial reactions to the news. Some shut down emotionally. "My world went black," is how Stephanie describes how she felt upon hearing of her mother's suicide. "I felt ice cold." Others feel physical upheaval, as if punched in the gut. We might be overwhelmed by uncontrollable wails or sobs, or we may experience rage or anger. We may experience denial, like the mother in the movie Dead Poets Society, who cries, "He's all right, he's all right," upon discovering her son's body. Another common response is to attribute the death to something other than suicide. If the cause of death is ambiguous, survivors may call it an accident. We might think, "She didn't mean to take all those pills. It must have been an accidental overdose." Or we may even hope that the death was actually a murder rather than a suicide. Perhaps some unknown intruder killed our loved one and staged it to look like a suicide. After Natalie's mother jumped off an 18-story building, Natalie found the idea of suicide so unbelievable that she wondered if some unknown assailant had pushed her off. If we could find an alternative explanation for the death, we could blame the death on accidental forces or an external villain, not our loved one. Sometimes in the face of tragic loss, we mistakenly believe we should not be mired in such feelings as grief or sorrow. Counselor Stephen Arterburn calls this the myth of instant peace. "I have heard people who have lost children, spouses, fortunes, and dreams say that they have this wonderful peace just moments after they hear the awful news. What they have is shock, not peace. Shock is a natural reaction designed to protect us, to cushion the reality and depth of our pain and other feelings. Those who profess instant peace will suffer a troubled future full of greater pain than the original loss and disappointment." While some degree of denial is common in most kinds of catastrophic loss, denial usually serves only as a temporary shock absorber to prepare us for future grief work. It is a psychological buffer zone to help us with the immediacy of the trauma, but should not become a permanent dwelling place for our grief. "Denial puts off what should be faced," writes Gerald Sitzer, "because those who dwell in denial actually avoid pain rather than confront it. Healing can be cut short." Denial may be a natural starting point for the grief experience, but it is only part of the journey. Whatever your initial reaction to the news of your loved one's suicide, know that there is no right or wrong way to respond. How you feel or what you think at the time of the tragic news is immediate and visceral, and it usually need not be evaluated, modified, or self-censored. It simply is. Granted, some survivors may need to be protected from responding in ways that may be destructive to themselves or others. When we receive the bad news, our minds and bodies respond with a defense mechanism, a survival instinct to keep us going. Because of individual circumstances and personalities, all of us will respond in different ways. Yet our various experiences will have much in common with those of other survivors. When I got the news, I felt numb. The news came as a shock, but not really as a surprise. Because of my dad's depression in the previous months, his suicide made sense. I could understand in my head why he would want to take his own life. But that rational assessment did little to diminish the enormous emptiness I felt within my chest. I couldn't grasp the reality of his death, and I certainly hadn't seen it coming. What are we to do when we are in the initial stages of shock? Shock incapacitates some survivors while it mobilizes others into action. Among the friends and family who have been left behind, some may be able to make decisions while others find themselves in a daze. I was grateful for the ways my wife helped me function in the immediate minutes and hours after I heard the news. If you sense that you can act with some degree of clarity, do what you can to help others If you find yourself at a loss, feel free to tell someone, "I don't think I can handle anything right now. I need you to take care of some things for me." Facts about suicide in the United States. In 2014, 42,773 Americans died by suicide, 117 suicides per day. Suicide is the 10th leading cause of death in the United States. More people die from suicide than from car accidents. There are approximately 25 suicide attempts for every suicide death. The annual age-adjusted suicide rate is 12.93 per 100,000 individuals. Suicide is the second leading cause of death for college students. Firearms account for 49.9% of all suicides. Men die by suicide 3.5 times more often than women. Women attempt suicide 3 times more often than men. White males accounted for 7 of 10 suicides in 2014. The rate of suicide is highest in middle age, white men in particular. We are not alone. Suicide bisects your life with a starkly clear line. Everything is divided into before and after. Overnight, my mother became a widow. My brother and I became fatherless. Instantly, everything had changed. Against our will, those of us who have experienced the suicide of a loved one have become part of a unique grieving community. Our particular kind of grief is incomprehensible to many, since death by suicide is radically different from death by car accident, heart attack, or old age. "We are like members of a secret society," one author writes. "It is a society that no one wants to be a part of, one that we wish we had not been initiated into." If you are a survivor of suicide, you are not alone. Every day, countless others experience the same horrible heartache. Millions across the country and around the world have known the searing pain, the gnawing anguish, the unanswered questions of a suicide. Some months after my father's death, I came across a book by a suicide survivor that described her experience. A month after her husband's suicide, Carla went to a local church's suicide survivor support group for the first time. She could not imagine what she might encounter. Perhaps a room full of crazy, disturbed people. She had no idea what it would be like to talk about her husband's death with complete strangers. She approached the meeting room, marked with a sign reading, "A safe place." There she found a group of normal-looking people drinking coffee and eating cookies, making small talk and exchanging pleasantries. Carla was sure she was in the wrong place. How could these people know anything of her trauma and grief? She started to leave, but was encouraged to stay. As the meeting began, the facilitator welcomed the group and asked people to introduce themselves and say why they were there. "My name is Ray," one man began. "My brother hung himself 2 years ago at Bear Mountain State Park. He was 36, my younger brother." "My name is Elizabeth. My father shot himself last year on Thanksgiving Day. It was 2 hours before we were going to eat." Elizabeth began to cry. "I'm Ivan. My son jumped in front of the subway 4 months, 2 weeks, and 3 days ago." He had been a high school sophomore. "My name is Hal. I found my 14-year-old daughter in the bathtub with a wrist slit on July 8, 1989. And so it continued. A heart surgeon had jumped out a window. A police detective shot himself the day before he retired. A mother overdosed on pills on her 75th birthday. A twin sister strangled herself with her bedsheets while under suicide watch at a psychiatric hospital. A wife turned on the car in the garage and died from carbon monoxide fumes. Finally, it was Carla's turn, and in tears she said, "My name is Carla, and this is my first meeting. It's my husband's birthday today. He would have been 44. He killed himself 4 weeks ago. He was a doctor, so he injected himself intravenously with some heavy-duty anesthetic. Up until tonight, I didn't know there were so many other people who could understand what I was talking about." As I read about Carla's experience, something resonated within me. It was horrifying to read about all the different ways people had killed themselves, and it seemed morbid for all these relatives to be talking about their loved ones' deaths. Yet strangely, I found it tremendously reassuring. By reading other people's stories, I realized that I was not alone. Others had gone through similar experiences and had felt the same emotions. Later, as I began to share my own experience in grief with those around me, I discovered that a number of my friends and coworkers had walked the same difficult road. They had lost a cousin, a fiancé, a friend from church. These friends told me in various ways, "I'm a survivor too." Many of those who resort to suicide have felt utterly alone in their depression or pain and have believed that nobody else knows how they feel. The fact is that many others share the same thoughts and struggles, and if they had known of others in their shoes, they might have found the hope to go on. Survivors, likewise, must not believe the lie that nobody knows how we feel. We are not alone in this trauma. Others have experienced the same tragedy and have weathered the storm. They have been able to go on. We can too. 2. Turmoil. Suicide carries in its aftermath a level of confusion and devastation that is, for the most part, beyond description. Psychologist K. Redfield Jameson. Night falls fast. "I keep thinking that he's not really dead," Ellen said. "That maybe they're wrong, that he's going to come back." I nodded in agreement. It simply did not seem real. I was in my mid-20s, and up to that time I had rarely thought about death. It was only an abstract concept, held off at a distance. I had figured that I would deal with it eventually, when my parents were older. But death had violently ambushed me. What was I supposed to do? How was I supposed to respond? Nobody had prepared me for anything like this. As we left town, we stopped at the office to drop off some things. I couldn't bring myself to go inside and face my friends and coworkers, so Ellen ran in. I later learned that our coworkers had called together an impromptu prayer meeting in the company lunchroom to pray for me and my family. Ellen came back with our pastor, Matthew, and his wife, Kim, who had gone to the office to catch us before we left town. They stood by our car to express their condolences and pray for us. I don't remember anything of what Matthew prayed, but I remember seeing tears running down Kim's face. She didn't even know my father. Why was she crying? Why wasn't I? During the 6.5-hour drive to Minnesota, I couldn't stop thinking about my dad. Random memories whirled through my mind. I last saw him over Thanksgiving, 3 months prior. We had visited him several times in the hospital where he was recovering from the stroke. He'd looked older and more frail. His left side wasn't working properly, and he shuffled when he walked. Though he was slightly depressed at his physical state, he had seemed very happy to see us. I learned some things about him I had never known before, like the fact that he didn't like the smell of new dollar bills when they come fresh out of the ATM. He actually stashed new bills around his office at work until the odor went away, so they wouldn't make his wallet smell funny. He asked about my life and career, and said that he'd like to help us with a down payment for a house when the time came. He thanked us for visiting and hugged us when we left. It was some of the best time I had ever spent with my dad. I didn't realize then that it would be the last time I would see him alive. A few weeks before his death, I had talked to him on the phone for what would be the last time. He had said very little. "Well, I'm feeling pretty low," he had said. "Sorry, I don't have much to say." I remembered thinking that I had never heard my dad so sad before. He seemed so vulnerable and weak, so unlike the independent, strong-willed, self-made man I'd known as my father. For the first time, perhaps, I recognized that my dad had deep fears and worries. I just didn't know how consuming his despair had become. We arrived at my parents' home late that afternoon. It was winter in Minnesota, so the ground was covered with snow, and gray skies cast a bleak pallor over the house. Several cars were parked in the driveway and on the street, signaling that friends and neighbors were with my mother. "Mom, I'm home," I said as I opened the front door. I saw her sitting in the living room with some people I recognized and others who were unfamiliar. Her face seemed oddly blank, as if a torrent of emotions had left her drained. She came over to embrace me somewhat awkwardly. "Dad loved you very much," she said to me. "If he had been in his right mind, he wouldn't have done this." I wasn't sure whether to agree or not, so I just hugged her. Mom sent me to pick up Ed, my younger brother, from church, where the youth pastor, Scott, said he'd be willing to help out with funeral arrangements. Back home, the phone rang constantly, as relatives and friends called to express their condolences to my mom. Over and over, she had to recount what had happened. What I pieced together was that following his stroke, my father had begun to show all the symptoms of clinical depression. In the last few weeks, he had lost perspective and constantly felt like a failure, guilty, hopeless. My mom had removed firearms and other weapons from the house, fearing that he would hurt himself. Then Dad tried to kill himself with a belt. Mom found out and got him to the hospital for several days of supervision. He had been back home for a few days when he told Mom that he wanted to be left alone for the night, that he didn't want her to come in or disturb him. Evidently, he took a coat hanger from the closet, stretched it open, hooked it on the headboard of the bed, and placed his head through it. He lay down on the bed and let his body weight pull the hanger against his neck, strangling him. I had no idea that anyone could kill himself that way. It spoke to me both of my father's determination and of his desperation. The next few days were a maelstrom of activity. As the eldest son, I did my best to act responsibly, helping with funeral arrangements, attending to guests, cleaning out the refrigerator. But through it all, I wandered in a confusing mix of emotion and heartache. I didn't know how I felt. I wasn't sure I could function. Each day was filled with uncertainty and a sense of dread. Grief and trauma. In grief, nothing stays put, writes C.S. Lewis. One keeps on emerging from a phase, but it always recurs, round and round. Everything repeats. Am I going in circles, or dare I hope I am on a spiral? Much has been written about stages of grief. The most widely used framework has five basic phases: denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and acceptance. Another source proposes 10 stages: shock, expression of emotion, depression and loneliness, physical distress, panic, guilt, anger and resentment, resistance, hope, and affirmation of reality. But grief is rarely so clear or so simple. The fact that counselors and researchers plot out different kinds of grief patterns suggests that people grieve differently and experience different cycles of emotions. Our grief recovery processes are not so easily charted. One author did not find the idea of stages of grief helpful because, "For one thing, I have still not moved beyond these stages, and I am not sure I ever will." He still finds himself angry at times, in denial at others. The problem with seeing grief in stages, he says, is that it raises the false expectation that we go through them only once. Again, that has not been true for me. I have revisited them again and again. Identifying stages of grief may provide a general idea of the kinds of patterns we might undergo, but our actual day-to-day experience can be volatile and erratic. This is especially true in cases of catastrophic loss, like suicide. The grief that suicide survivors experience is described by psychologists as complicated grief or complicated bereavement. Grief usually refers to a normal anticipated loss, such as death by old age or a long illness. But complicated grief involves an additional trauma, such as suicide or murder. Counselors Mel Lorenz and Daniel Green define grief as the natural expected reaction to a loss. Trauma, on the other hand, is defined as the experience of something shocking happening to someone, physically or psychologically, that produces some kind of inner injury and affects the person's ability to function in normal ways. Those of us who experience complicated bereavement are actually grappling with two realities, grief and trauma. Grief is normal. Trauma is not. The combination of circumstances is like a vicious 1-2 punch. We are grieving the death of our loved one, and we are reeling from the trauma of the suicide. The first is difficult enough. The second may seem unbearable. Suicide heightens the agony of loss. Different kinds of loss are grieved differently. The loss of a child, for instance, brings a different sort of grief than the loss of a spouse or an elderly parent. Each kind of death raises its own issues. A teen's death brings feelings of regret that a life of budding potential was cut short. The death of a wife or husband may leave the surviving spouse struggling with the challenges of widowhood and single parenting. Each of these losses is difficult, even in the most normal of circumstances. Suicide contemplates and intensifies each grief. What would already be a heartbreaking teen death becomes even more tragic as a teen's suicide. How a family grieves for a teen suicide may look very different from grief over a grandfather's suicide. Traumatic grief is not a linear process, a straight path mapped out from one starting point to a final destination. Rather, it is a journey filled with twists and turns, unexpected detours and dead ends that force us back over ground we thought we had already covered. Often, several different overlapping emotions may assault us at once, and we find ourselves caught in cycles of good days and bad. The emotional whirlwind. The word I use to describe our experience of this combination of grief and trauma is turmoil. Following a suicide, we find ourselves in severe emotional and perhaps physical turmoil as our feelings and thoughts fly in all directions. We may discover that we are experiencing contradictory emotions at once, such as a melancholy sadness, normal grief, along with violent outrage at the trauma of suicide. Here are some categories of turmoil that suicide survivors go through. They are listed in no particular order, since they may occur at any time and do not necessarily fit any prescribed pattern for stages of grief. Shock, disbelief, and numbness. C.S. Lewis writes that grief feels like being mildly drunk or concussed. There is a sort of invisible blanket between the world and me. I find it hard to take in what anyone says. The immediate response to suicide is total disbelief, writes a suicide survivor. The act itself is so incomprehensible that we enter into a state where we feel unreal and disconnected. The days right after a suicide are filled with confusion. We are caught up in the whirlwind of funeral preparations and decisions, talking to strangers such as police officers, as well as close friends and relatives, sorting through legal and financial matters. It leaves us bewildered. We hope that it's all a bad dream, a temporary alternate reality that we only need to endure for a while before we return to the real universe. In our disbelief and numbness, we often shut down any emotions that come close to happiness or joy. We approach life with dead seriousness. We avoid TV sitcoms because we find none of the jokes funny. How can people laugh when this world is so painful? How can anything be funny anymore? We feel as if we will never smile again. Distraction. After a suicide, it is often difficult to concentrate. In the weeks afterward, I sometimes found myself sitting at my desk, staring at the computer screen for an hour or more, unable to think about the tasks before me. I would walk around not knowing where I was going or what I was doing. In the middle of meetings, church services, or even personal conversations, I would zone out and then come back to realize that I had not heard what had been said for the past several minutes. Friends of survivors may need an extra measure of patience in the early days of grief. Survivors may find themselves apologizing frequently, saying things like, "I'm sorry, could you say that again? I didn't catch what you said." It's not that our hearing is going bad. It's that traumatic grief has caused an inability to focus. Sorrow and despair. Tears may be uncontrollable.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.